Hello students, today in this video I am going to discuss about conjunction control algorithms. It includes general principles of conjunction control, conjunction prevention policies, conjunction control in virtual circuit subnets, conjunction control in datagram subnets, load shedding and jitter control. First, we will see meaning of the term conjunction. When too many packets are present in the subnet, the performance of the subnet degrades, and this situation is called as conjunction. When a number of packets dumped into the subnet by the hosts is within the carrying capacity of the subnet, they are all delivered and the number delivered is proportional to the number sent. However, as traffic increases, the router are no longer able to cope with increased traffic and they begin to lose the packets. At very high traffic, performance collapses completely and almost no packets are delivered. Conjunction can be brought on by several factors. If all of a sudden streams of packets begins arriving on 3 or 4 input lines and all need the same output line, a queue will be built up. If there is insufficient memory to hold all of them, packets will be lost. Adding more memory may help up to the point. But if routers have an infinite amount of memory, conjunction gets worse. It is not better because the time packets get to the front of the queue, they have already timed out and duplicates have been sent. All these packets will be dutifully forwarded to the next router, increasing the load all the way to the destination. Slow processors can also cause conjunction. If the router's CPUs are slow at performing the tasks required of them, queues can be built up. Even though there is excess line capacity, similarly, low bandwidth lines also cause conjunction. Upgrading the lines but not changing the processors and or vice versa often helps a little but frequently just shifts the bottleneck. The real problem is frequently a mismatch between parts of the system. This problem will persist until all the components are in balance. The difference between conjunction control and flow control is conjunction control has to do with making sure the subnet is able to carry the offered traffic. It is a global issue involving the behavior of all the hosts, all the routers, store and forwarding processing within the routers, and all other factors that tends to diminish the carrying capacity of the subnet. Flow control, in contrast, relates to the point-to-point traffic between a given sender and a given receiver. Its job is to make sure that a fast sender cannot continually transmit faster data than the receiver is able to absorb it. Flow control frequently involves some direct feedback from the receiver to the sender to tell the sender how things are doing at the other end. For example, suppose fiber optic network with a capacity of 1000 gigabits per second on which the supercomputer is trying to transfer a file to the personal computer which runs at a 1 Gbps. Although there is no conjunction, flow control is needed to force the supercomputer to stop frequently and give the personal computer a chance to breathe. The reason conjunction control and flow control are often confused is that Some congestion control algorithms operate by sending message back to the various sources, telling them to slow down when the network gets into the trouble. Thus, a host can get a slowdown message either because the receiver cannot handle the load or because the network cannot able to handle it. Then we will see general principles of the congestion control. The congestion control approach leads to dividing all solutions into two groups, open loop and closed loop. Open loop solutions attempt to solve the problem by good design, in essence, to make sure it does not occur in the first place. Once the system is up and running, mid-course corrections are not made. Tools for doing open loop control include deciding when to accept new traffic, deciding when to discard packets and which one packets are to be discarded, as well as making scheduling decisions at various points in the network. All of these have in common the fact that they make decisions without regard to the current state of the network. In contrast, closed loop solutions are based on concept of feedback loop. This approach has three parts when applied to congestion control. These three parts or steps are shown in the slide. The first one is monitor the system to detect when and where congestion occurs. Second is pass this information to places where action can be taken. Third, adjust system operation to correct the problem. A variety of metrics can be used to monitor the subnet for congestion. Main among these are the percentage of all packets discarded for lack of buffer space, the average queue length, the number of packets that time out and are retransmitted, the average packet delay, and the standard deviation of packet delay. In all these cases, rising numbers indicate growing congestion. The second step in the feedback loop is to transfer the information about the congestion from the point where it is detected to the point where something can be done about it. The obvious way is for the router detecting the congestion is to send the packet to the traffic source or sources announcing the problem. Of course, these extra packets increases the load at the moment when the subnet is congested. However, other possibilities also exist. For example, a bit or field can be reserved in every packet for routers to fill in whenever congestion gets above some threshold level. When a router detects this congested state, it fills in the field in all outgoing packets to warn the neighbors. Still another approach is to have hosts or routers periodically send probe packets out to explicitly ask about congestion. This information can then be used to route traffic around problem areas. Some radio stations have helicopters flying around their cities to report on road congestion to make it possible for their mobile listeners to route their packets around hotspots. In our case, we will replace cars by packets. Many congestion control algorithms are known. We know that they are divided into open loop and closed loop. They further divide the open loop algorithms into ones that act at the source versus ones that act at the destination. The closed loop algorithms are also divided into two subcategories, explicit feedback versus implicit feedback. In explicit feedback algorithms, packets are sent back from one point of congestion to warn the source. The implicit algorithms the source deduces the existence of conjunction by making local observations, such as the time needed for acknowledgement to come back. The presence of conjunction means that the load is greater than the resources that can handle. Two solutions comes into mind are increase the resources or decrease the load. For example, the subnet may start using dial-up telephone lines to temporarily increase the bandwidth between certain points. On satellite system, increasing transmission power often gives higher bandwidth. Splitting traffic over multiple routes instead of always using the best one may also effectively increases the bandwidth. Finally, spare routers that are normally used only as backups can be put up online to give more capacity when serious congestion appears. Then we will see congestion prevention policies. These policies are a part of open loop systems. These systems are designed to minimize congestion in the first place rather than letting it happen and reacting after the fact. They try to achieve their goals by using appropriate policies at various levels. Figure shows different policies at data link layer, network layer, and transport layers. Let us start at the data link layer. The retransmission policy is concerned with how fast a sender times out and what it transmits upon timeout. A jumpy sender that times out quickly and retransmits all outstanding packets using go back n will put a heavier load on the system as compared to the selective repeat mechanism. With respect to the congestion control, selective repeat is clearly better than go back n. Then acknowledgement policy also affects congestion. If each packet is acknowledged immediately, the acknowledgement packets generates extra traffic. However, if acknowledgements are saved up to piggyback onto reverse traffic, extra timeouts and retransmissions may result. A tight flow control scheme, that is a small window, reduces the data rate and thus helps in fighting the congestion. At the network layer, the choice between using virtual circuits and using datagrams affects the congestions, since many congestion control algorithms work only with virtual circuit subnets. Packet queuing and service policy relates to whether routers have one queue per input line, one queue per output line, or both. It also relates to the order in which packets are processed, that is round robin or priority based. Discard policy is the rule telling which packet is dropped when there is no space. A good policy can help to reduce the congestion. A good routing algorithm can help to avoid the congestion by spreading the traffic over all the lines, whereas the bad one can send too much traffic over already congested lines. Finally, packet lifetime management deals with how long a packet may live before being discarded. If it is too long, lost packets may clog up, the worse for the long time. But if it is too short, packets may sometimes time out before reaching to the destination. Thus, it introduces the retransmissions. In the transport layer, the same issues occurs as in the data link layer. But in addition, determining the timeout interval in header, because the transit time across the network is less predictable than the transit time over the wire between two routers. If a timeout interval is too short, extra packets will be sent unnecessarily. If it is too long, congestion will be reduced, but the response time will suffer whenever the packet is lost. Then we will see congestion control in virtual circuits. One technique that is widely used to keep congestion that has already started from getting worse in the is admission control. The idea is simple. Once congestion has been signaled, no more virtual circuits are set up until the problem has gone away. Thus, attempts to set up new transport layer connections fail. Letting more people in just makes matters worse. While this approach is crude, it is simple and easy to carry out. In the telephone system, when switch goes overloaded, it also practices admission control by not giving a dial tones. An alternative approach is to allow a new virtual circuit but carefully route all new virtual circuits around problem area. For example, consider a subnet shown in the figure in which two routes are congested as indicated. Suppose that a host attached to router A wants to set up a connection to host attached to router B. Normally, this connection would pass through one of the congested routers. To avoid this situation, we can redraw the subnet as shown in figure B, omitting the congested routers and all of their lines. The dashed line shows a possible route for the virtual circuit that avoids the congested routers. Another strategy relating to virtual circuits is to negotiate an agreement between the host and subnet when the virtual circuit is set up. This agreement normally specifies the volume and shape of the traffic, quality of the service required, and other parameters. To keep its part of the agreement, the subnet will typically reserve resources along the path when the circuit is set up. These resources can include table and buffer space in the routers and bandwidth on the lines. In this way, congestion is unlikely to occur on the new virtual circuits because all the necessary resources are guaranteed to be available. This kind of reservation can be done all the time as a standard operating procedure or only when the subnet is congested. A disadvantage of doing it all the time is that it tends to waste resources. Next is congestion control in datagram subnets. The congestion control in datagram subnets includes the warning bit technique, choke packet concepts, and hop by hop choke packets. First, the warning bit concept. The old wide area network architecture signaled the warning state by setting a special bit in the packet's header. When a packet arrived at the destination, the transport layer entity copied the bit into the new next acknowledgement sent back to the resource. And then resource or source machine has to act accordingly about the reduction in the transmission rate. As long as the router was in the warning state, it continued to set the warning bit, which meant that the source continued to get acknowledgement with warning bit set. The source monitored the fraction of acknowledgements with the bit set and adjusted its transmission rate accordingly. As long as the warning bits continued to flow in, the source continued to decrease its transmission rate. Then choke packets. The previous congestion control algorithm is not fair. It uses a roundabout means to tell the source to slow down. Why not just tell it directly? In this approach, the router sends a choke packet back to the source host, giving it the destination found in the packet. The original packet is tagged so that it will not generate any more choke packets further along the path and is then forwarded in the usual way. When the source host gets the choke packet, it is required to reduce traffic sent to the specific destination by X%. Since other packets aimed at the same destination are probably already underway and will generate yet more choke packets, the host should ignore choke packets referring to that destination for a fixed in time interval. After that period has expired, the host listens for more choke packets for another interval. If one arrives, the line is still congested, so the host reduces the flow still more and begins ignoring choke packets again. If no choke packets arise during the listening period, the host may increase the flow again. The feedback implicit in this protocol can help in preventing congestion, yet not throttle any flow unless trouble occurs. Hosts can reduce traffic by adjusting their policy parameters. For example, their window size. Typically, the first choke packet causes the data rate to be reduced to 50% of the previous rate. The next one causes the reduction to 25% and so on. Increases are done in smaller increments to prevent congestion from reoccurring quickly. Several variations on this congestion control algorithm have been proposed. For one, the routers can maintain several thresholds. Depending on which threshold has been crossed, the choke packet can contain a mild warning or stern warning or ultimatum. Then, hope-by-hope choke packets. Figure A shows a choke packet that affects only the source. Means here, in the figure, we have shown the routers A, B, C, D, E, and F. Suppose A transmits information to D and D observes the congestion. Then router D generates the choke packet and transmits to F. Here. Then F forwards this choke packet to E and E forwards the choke packet to A. Then the traffic between or the flow between A and A is get reduced. Then in next page, traffic between E and F is get reduced. And finally, the traffic between F and D is get reduced. That is, here traffic between A and D is get reduced. This mechanism is called as a choke packet that affects only the source. Means here traffic is reduced by, or transmission rate is reduced by, only source machine or source router. In second mechanism, again, if traffic is observed by D, choke packet, it generates the choke packet and forwards to F, and then F here takes the corrective action and reduces the flow and forwards the choke packet to E. When E receives the choke packet, it reduces the flow and forwards the choke packet to A, and finally A also reduces the transmission rate. That means here every router takes part in reduction of the transmission rate. So it is called as a choke packet that affects each hop it passes through. Then next is load shedding. Load shedding is a fancy way of saying that when routers are being overloaded by packets that they cannot handle. They just throw them away. The term comes from the world of electric power generation, where it refers to the practice of utilities intentionally blocking out certain areas to save the entire grid from collapsing on hot summer days when the demand of our electricity exceeds than the supply. The router having large number of packets can just pick packets at random to drop. But usually it can be done, or it can do better than that by taking some decisions. For example, which packets to discard may depend on applications running. For example, for file transfer applications, old packets are more important than new packets, so that under overloading conditions, router can discard new packets. In contrast, for multimedia application, new packets are more important than the old packets. Under such situation, under overload conditions, old packets were discarded than the new packets. A step above this is in intelligence requires cooperation from the senders. For many applications, some packets are more important than others. For example, certain algorithms for compressing video periodically transmits an entire frame and then sends subsequent frames as a difference between the first frame and the current frame. In this case, dropping a packet that is a part of difference is preferable to dropping one that is a part of the full frame. To implement an intelligent discard policy, applications must mark their packets in priority classes to indicate how important they are. If they do this, then when packets have to be discarded, routers can first drop packets having the lowest priority or from the lowest class. Then they will drop the next lowest class and so on. The incentive might be in the form of money, with the low priority packets being cheaper to send than the high priority ones. Alternatively, senders might be allowed to send high priority packets under conditions of light load. But as the load increased, they would be discarded, thus encouraging the users to stop sending them. Another option is to allow hosts to exceed the limits specified in the agreement negotiated when the virtual circuit was set up, but subject to condition that all excess traffic be marked as a low priority. Such a strategy is actually not a bad idea because it makes more efficient use of idle resources, allowing hosts to use them as long as nobody else is interested. Then, next one is random early detection. It is well known that dealing with congestion after it is first detected is more effective than letting it after detection. This observation leads to idea of discarding packets before all the buffer space is really exhausted. A popular algorithm for doing this is called as random early detection. In some transport layers or transport layer protocols, for example TCP, the response to lost packets is for the source to slow down. The reasoning behind this logic is that TCP was designed for wired networks and wired networks are very reliable. So, lost packets are mostly due to buffer overruns rather than transmission errors. This fact can be exploited to help in congestion reduction. By having routers drop packets before the situation has become hopeless. The idea is that there is time for action to be taken before it is too late. To determine when to start discarding, routers maintain a running average of their queue lengths. When the average queue length on some line exceeds the threshold, the line is said to be congested and action is to be taken. Since the router probably cannot tell which source is causing most of the trouble, picking a packet at random from the queue that triggered the action is probably as good as it can do. How should the router tell the source about the problem? One way is to send it a choke packet, as we have just discussed. A problem with that approach is that it puts even more load on the already congested network. A different strategy is to just discard the selected packet and not report it. The source will eventually notice the lack of acknowledgement and take action. Since it knows that lost packets are generally caused by congestion and discards, it will respond by slowing down instead by trying harder. This implicit form of feedback only works when sources respond to lost packets by slowing their transmission rate. In wireless networks, where most losses are due to noise on the air link, this approach cannot be used. The next one is jitter control. For applications such as audio and video streaming, it does not matter much if the packets take 20 milliseconds or 30 milliseconds to be delivered, as long as the transit time is constant. The variation in the packet arrival times is called as a jitter. High jitter, for example, having some packets taking 20 milliseconds and other taking 30 milliseconds to arrive, will give an uneven quality to the sound or movie. And jitter is illustrated in this figure. The range chosen must be feasible, of course. It must take into account the speed of light, transit time, and the minimum delay through the routers, and perhaps leave a little slack for some inevitable delays. The jitter can be bounded by computing the expected transit time for each hop along the path. When a packet arrives at a router, the router checks to see how much the packet is behind or ahead of its schedule. This information is stored in the packet and updated at every hop. If the packet is ahead of schedule, it is just held long enough to get it back on schedule. If it is behind schedule, the router tries to get it out the door quickly. In fact, the algorithm for determining which of the several packets competing for an output line should go next can always choose the packet furthest behind in its schedule. In this way, packets that are ahead of the schedule slowed down and the packets that are behind schedule gets speeded up, in both cases reducing the amount of jitter. In some applications such as video on demand, jitter can be eliminated by buffering at the receiver and then fetching the data for display from the buffer instead of from a network in real time. However, for other applications, especially those that require real-time interaction between people, such as internet telephony and video conferencing, the delay inherent in buffering is not acceptable. This is about jitter control. Thank you.